wishing you a happy and peaceful retreat, and I now hand over to Ajahn Brahm.
Now life doesn't go according to plan, so we just let things roll. And that's so important with our meditation as well. We don't try and force it this way, force it that way. We go with what's happening in our mind. And we learn to use it, to go with it, to relax with it. And then we find that everything gets very, very peaceful. A very quick, simple little piece of advice while we're getting all these things organized. That sometimes people say, do you have to have everything just right before you can get into deep meditation? Do you have to have really good health, really strong, a nice chair, not too hot, not too cold? Does everything have to be just right? And of course, you can never get that. So, there was a little story which was in one of the first books, Opening the Door of Your Heart, or otherwise known as Who Ordered This Truckload of Shit I've Been Done. And it was that. That's what I wanted the title to be, but in the United States they just wouldn't have it. No, you're crazy. Anyway, in that story was something which changed a lot of the way I looked at life. A story from Leo Tolstoy, The Emperor's Three Questions. When is the most important time, which was now? Who is the most important person? And at that time I didn't know the answer, when they said there's a one right in front of you. Is the most important person. And the most important thing to do is to care. Not to control, not to change, not to get rid of things, but care for things. And I realized later on that that's not just for life, that's for meditation. Now is the most important time. Forget what happened a moment ago. Forget how many minutes there are to go. You only have now. Now is where your future is made. Now is where you learn from. You never learn from your past, you learn from your present. From now. This is where the most learning comes from. And this is where our future is made. Now. So this is important. Whatever you're experiencing, care for it. So, we don't complain. We don't push things away. We don't think that something is wrong or missing. This moment is important. Care for it. Don't try and control it or get rid of it. So in this meditation, you're starting off, it may be hot, it may be cold, it may be noisy, not really comfortable yet. Just whatever you're experiencing, it's important. It's teaching you something, you're learning from it. And if you care for this moment, then you let it be. You don't need to do anything. Because this moment is important. You don't develop it. You don't get rid of it. You care for it. In every moment. If you understand that, you don't need to listen to any more teachings. You can meditate anywhere, anytime, with anything. If you think you have to be aware of your breath, or you have to watch the sankharas in your body, or you have to do this, have to do that, then you have lots of work to do. When you realize this moment is the most important thing in the whole world. And all you have to do is care for it. That's meditation in a nutshell. Please remember that from the very beginning. Everything else is extra. That's the main course. Now I'm going to add the gravy. So, if you'd like to get yourself comfortable, we do a guided meditation for, I don't know, half an hour maybe. Because I'm not sure, have you ever seen TED Talks? So now I qualify to put it on TED Talk. This is a joke. Will you say any words, TED? What did TED Talk say anyway?
Nothing. It's in noble silence.
Noble silence. Okay. So, here you go. So close your eyes. What's in front of your awareness right now? Whatever you are aware of is the most important thing in the world. Usually, when I start meditating, it's my body. When I'm not busy thinking, planning or cracking jokes, then my body comes up into my awareness. And sometimes I just do not give my body enough care and awareness and importance. So right now, my body is important. So I'm going to care for it. Make sure you're in a comfortable position. You know, sitting on the floor sometimes, you know, it's too hard. If you can, you know, just get some cushions, adjust. Eventually you find out the best possible position for your body. When you find it's comfortable, it doesn't cause you any problems. We know that we try and keep silence in this hall as much as possible. It's not just the noise from people, it's also the noise from our body. The aches, the pains, the itches, the coughs. These are things which disturb us more than sound. And the only way we can calm down our body is to be aware and careful. So I'm now going to give some gravy. Be aware of your legs right now. From the toes to the top of the thighs. Really checking that they are comfortable. Not just sort of caring for them, but really deeply caring for them. You know what it's like when somebody cares for you? You know they do. And they show it. You relax. There's something about being with people who aren't going to hurt you or harm you. Which means that everything just is loose. You're not trying to protect yourself. You don't need to. They're not going to harm you, judge you, criticize you. They just have to be free. Imagine that with all the muscles, ligaments, bones, skin, anything in your legs. They're totally safe, so you don't need to tense up. Relaxing the legs to the max. And you're mindful, you're aware, because in this moment your legs are important, fully important. Nothing else is important. It is called mindfulness in the moment. And the compassion is the caring. Compassion calms things down, heals, frees, settles. It's one of the most important fuels which drive the meditation. The other one is awareness. I'm feeling my legs now, they're really important. Mindful of them, calming them down, caring for them. And then my legs now start to tingle. Relax at ease. If ever you have difficulty sleeping at night, just do this if you're preliminary. Feeling the legs, experiencing them, calming them down. Until the legs get fully peaceful. And then move to your bottom, your buttocks. I say that because I used to fidget it a lot. You sort of get comfortable, but really wasn't comfortable. I wasn't caring enough. Sometimes because I wasn't caring and my bottom was on the cushion or chair, one of my legs would, as they say, go to sleep, become numb. I was cutting off some blood supply. Just because I wasn't meticulous and careful enough about how I position my bottom on the cushion or the chair. You want to fit it now. Get it comfortable. Next, I put my awareness on my back. Now the back is the most important thing in the world for me. I know that when I'm sitting on the floor, I love to stretch my back at this point. Get a good old stretch. You know, kangaroos do that in the forest, possums. You see, all these animals do these great stretches. They really feel good afterwards, and we do that as well. I feel all the endorphins going through my body. It's a big, free pleasure. And also, it allows me to let go and the back relaxes. Feeling really loose, because I care for what's in front of my mind. The experience, the sensations of the back. And then, look at my hands. It's not always you put your hands in the lap or put your hands on your knees. Now I've got to hold the TED. The other one I've got to hold the microphone. So I've got to make sure that both are as comfortable as I possibly can make it. Moving my awareness up to my shoulders. Really important now, that in front of my mind, they're my meditation object. I'm noticing the experience of the shoulders right now. And then I care for them. Real care relaxes in the ears. Trying to do something, get rid of things, just makes things more tense. I care for my shoulders. Really do with my mind. Giving kindness, metta, compassion to my own shoulders. So I get very loose, very free. It feels good. Then move up my neck. Got a little irritation. There we go. In my neck. If you need to cough, please do so. Don't resist it. As I've been telling people. We're starting a meditation retreat we call volcano effect. We're trying to control, suppress. For noble reason, we don't want to disturb others. What happens is that you disturb them even more. Because when you do cough, it's like an explosion. So, be kind to your throat. Aware, in this moment, and calm. Real compassion. Your body, the part which is called your throat. Then move out to your face, your head. And I'm moving my head round and round until I can get the most comfortable position for my head on top of the neck. And lastly, I relax my facial muscles. I can't afford to go to a spa and get Botox injections to get rid of the wrinkles in my face. So I relax it by myself. Aware. Kind. And finally, everything gets loose. Loose, relax. There's a certain feeling of relaxation, especially right now in my face. All the muscles are loose. Nothing is tight. And then I look at the whole body, from head to toe. One by one, I've relaxed the whole body. I feel so free, peaceful. If this is all I did in my meditations, this is all as far as I got. I still love my meditation. this is much. It just so, feels so good. The delight in relaxation. Have you ever come across that delight beginning meditation? Your body feels so nice. Just like when you wake up in the morning, you don't have to go to the toilet, cuddling your underneath your duvet, you just snuggle into your pillow. There's a delight there. Just be aware of that delight and care for it. It takes you deeper into relaxation. Now once my body is relaxed, I turn to the center of my mind, my emotional world, and to know what I mean, I use a very easy exercise. I ask myself, how peaceful am I? Or how agitated? And I give it a scale from 1 to 10. 1 means really peaceful, 10 means very, very agitated. Having given that scale 1 peaceful, 10 agitated, and figuring out where in that scale of my mind is at this moment. All that really does is make me aware, pointing my attention to what I call the peace on the top. You have a thermometer and take the temperature of your body. This is a peaceometer, measuring how much peace or how much agitation you have. The reason why I like people to become aware of that gets right to the heart of the meditation. Once you're aware of the peaceometer, see if you can notice the needle change, move. Sometimes it gets more and more peaceful. Sometimes more and more agitated. Why? See what the causes are for calming the mind down so you become more peaceful. Don't expect to get it right at first. It takes some learning. Mindfulness gives you feedback. There's a kindness, letting go, letting things be that. Is what causes relaxation. And now you can become aware, maybe, of your breathing. Usually, when everything else stops, then the breath comes up by itself. So you can notice your breath coming into your body, not forcing it. Allow it to do it by itself. Noticing the breath coming in. Noticing the breath going out. Breathing in. Breathing out. And to help meditation, you can, with every in-breath, you can say, breathing in peace. Breathe out. Breathe out, let go. Breathing in. without anger. And as you say these words, when you're breathing, whether it's good health, happiness, whatever you want to breathe in, energy, imagine it coming in and then being death, coming into your body and mind. Everything you'd like to release from your mind or body, an illness, a tiredness, a disease, negativity, imagine that going out with every out-breath, breathing in peace, breathing out, let go. Breathing in peace, breathing out, let go. relax with the body. How peaceful is the life. Sometimes you have to hear them again and again and again and again, the same teachings, to be brainwashed, because it goes against everything else one does in life. If you want to get on in this life, you have to work hard. And then you're tested, and you get degrees or pieces of paper if you pass. We don't do pieces of paper here, except for the questions that are thrown away afterwards. We don't give certificates. However, there was one place in Colombo, Sri Lanka, some years ago, which did give certificates. Because I heard this from a friend in California, in San Francisco, who told me the story of this old auntie from the backwaters of Sri Lanka, who was visiting her family in Colombo. And her family were very happy to see their old auntie, but they thought, what can we get our old auntie? What can we do for her? Because she was a very devoted Buddhist. But one of these Buddhists, they thought, it just goes to temples, offers food to monks, and chants and stuff, all the superficial stuff. So they thought, we're going to give our grandmother, our auntie, a real gift. And they heard there was a retreat, a meditation retreat, at a nearby center. And there it was much longer than just a weekend. I think it was almost like 2 weeks. And as well as a meditation, you're also taught some basic Buddhism. And at the end of the 2 weeks, the teachers there will give you an interview and give you a little test to actually assess your progress. It was very expensive, but the family club together to actually to pay for it. And at the end of the retreat, they gave the test and interview and exam to this woman. And they came up to her and said, amazing. We have agreed, having interviewed you about your meditation experiences and your understanding of the Dhamma. And we've all agreed that you are on the first stage of enlightenment. I call it a stream winner, which is a wonderful achievement. And as soon as I gave her the certificate, confirming she was a stream winner, she got very, very, very upset and angry. And they said, why are you so angry? Being a stream winner in Sinhalese as a soul one, oh, that's such an amazing achievement. Why are you so upset? Her witch, she looked at them in the eye and said, you don't remember me, do you? No, who are you? I was here a few years ago. And you didn't say I was at the first stage of enlightenment. You gave me the Anukampa certificate. You said I was at the third stage. Now you're demoting me. Which was the fourth stage of enlightenment, streaming in once returning, non-return, and full enlightenment. And last time they gave her the third stage, it's like giving you a PhD and now they're going to give you a BA. And then it closed down a few weeks after that story got around. It's just a scam. We don't give certificates. If there's certificates, there's something for you to get. It's just like the world, isn't it? The getting on in the world. And I'm now 43 years as a monk. When, in the Buddhist tradition, after 10 years they call you a Thera, T-H-E-R-A. Now please pronounce that properly, it's not a Thera, it's a Thera. And after 20 years they call you Maha-Thera. And after 30 years they call you Mega-Thera. Actually they don't, I'm making this up. And after 40 years, what's after Mega? Giga. Now you know why I'm off a lot. Giggle to her. That's so ridiculous, isn't it? Just like attainments and levels and hierarchies. So we don't have that. Because, as my master teacher, Ajahn Brahm, always said, we meditate to let go of things, not to gain things. We're not going to amass more experiences or more levels. We're trying to let go of things, be more free, have less burdens. Instead of like being materialist, you know, measuring yourself by how big your house is, or how many possessions you have, or how luxurious your car is, you don't measure like that. You measure about how much you haven't got, how much you've lost, losing all your anxiety, all your fear, losing all the
the problems of the trauma of the past, losing all the worries, losing all the ill will and the wanting. In short, we meditate to get lost, to be a loser, not a winner, to see how little we have. You know, the less you have, the less of a target you are, the less of an ego you have, which means people can say all sorts of things to you. Right, as people used to say, they said, wow, you had a good degree from a good university, you could have made something in life. You're a loser, Ajahn Brahm. Loser, loser, loser. And I thank them, said, thank you for that wonderful compliment. And it's so accurate. I'm a loser, and I really encourage it. Being a loser is a wonderful, wonderful achievement. Seeing how free you can be. Even when I go travelling, I haven't got it here, but many of you have seen my suitcase. It was at the, what's that called, the place I went this afternoon, Kensington. That's all I have when I go travelling. Just one little bag. So it's great when I go through the customs, when I arrive somewhere, whether it's in the US or when I get back to Australia. They always ask me, sir, where's your baggage? I say, this is my baggage, just this. And they ask, why haven't you got a suitcase? Why haven't you got anything? I say, well, I'm supposed to be like a bird. You never find birds flying through the air with suitcases. I've never seen migrating birds carrying a backpack or a bum bag or anything like that. And you know what the customs officers said to me? They said, well done, sir. Because I said, I'm a monk. They said, well done, a real monk. Off you go. And they let me through. It's wonderful when you have few possessions. It's so light, so free. It's not just physical possessions, it's mental possessions as well. So you don't worry about anything. You let go. So I don't worry about much. You know, just whatever happens, happens. We get a nice place for Anukampa. We don't get a nice place for Anukampa. We don't call it Anukampa anymore, we find a new word for it. Chandakampa. A camper for Chanda. Because she's a camper at the moment, she's got no place to stay. She camps out in one person's house, and she camps out in another person's house. She camps out somewhere else. So it's Anukampa society. So anyway, when we have few things, then we have little to worry about. And this is especially true in meditation. See how much you can lose. Now in meditation, I ask sometimes people, when is the most happy experience of your life so far? So far, now, not just when your football team wins, or when you find out you get made redundant from your workplace with lots of money. I mean, when you really feel really deeply happy, when you're sitting in a place where you're not waiting for things to finish, where you're with people and you don't want to be with anyone else except the person you're with right now. You don't want to go anywhere except just to be right here. Beautiful moments of contentment. Those are what we call a taste of freedom. Contentment, happiness. In this moment, I don't want anything to change. Moments of perfection. And you notice that those wonderful moments in your life, they're not really perfect. They could be better. But in those moments, you let go of all wanting. You're happy to be here with whoever's with you. There's beautiful moments of freedom. Because when you want things, when you want to get rid of things, that causes a lot of tension, a lot of pain in the mind. And it goes opposite to meditation. Contentment, happy to be here. That's freedom. You don't know what I mean. That there was a story which I wrote in the Mindfulness Bliss and Beyond book. It's a very wonderful story where one of my monks went to teach in prison, and when they were teaching in prison, after a few sessions, the prisoners asked this monk, "Can you stay behind? We've got some cheese and chocolate and cups of tea for you. You know, just we want to talk with you, find out more about you." And so they started a discussion what it's like as a monk. Same goes for a nun. And look, when we get an Anukampa monastery for bhikkhunis, don't worry about maintenance or feeding a nun, because that happened the first time that monks came to Australia from Ajahn Brahm's monastery. There was, I think it was the head of the English Sangha Trust at the time, a fellow called Colin Ash. And Mr. Colin Ash, he was a professor of economics at Reading University, if I'm not wrong, and also an advisor for the Bank of England. He knew his stuff. So when people asked him, "How much does it cost to look after a Buddhist monk?" And he did the figures. He crunched the numbers. And he came out with the amazing conclusion that it is cheaper to look after a monk than it is to look after a dog. Dogs cost much more money than looking after a nun. And when he said that, I thought there's lots of similarities. Like, dogs eat out of a bowl. You go to the monasteries, so do nuns. They live in little huts in the garden, I'm talking about dogs, called kennels. A slightly bigger hut, but the same idea. Very simple. And you take the dog for a walk in the morning, so you can take the nun for a walk. Always very pleasant, wax her tail if she had one. And they even give you a lick. And they're always really nice to be around. They teach you compassion and kindness. So, we thought that after he said that, how cheap they were and how great they were for company and just looking after you and inspiring you, he came to the conclusion that in England every home should have one. So anyway, where was I going with this? I said, well, it doesn't really cost that much. So anyway, when you are a monk or a nun, it's great to be able just to have little. And those people who come to my monastery, you go into the abbot's residence. The abbot's residence in Bodhidharma Monastery, where I hang out, is a cave. Nothing in there. Beautiful. And I try my hardest to lose everything, so I don't get much possession. So at the end of this trip, please don't give me anything. I have to take it away afterwards, give it away, or leave it somewhere on a train. And people gave me, the Venerable Chan gave me so much chocolate. She gave me some to carry, and it must have been sort of psychological, because I left it on the train. But someone else could actually have it. So it's great when you don't carry stuff around. Beautiful. So anyway, you don't carry the past around. Yeah, there's lots of stuff happened to me, good, bad stuff, but the past. If you remember the past, what do you remember? What do you keep in your memory bank? And it's usually all the bad stuff, isn't it? All the terrible things which somebody just said or did or whatever happened. It's totally insane, as far as I'm concerned, to always remember the past bad stuff which happened to you. Why don't you focus on that? Yeah, it's a good retreat, nice talk, but we had to wait too long to get in here. Ah, oh, come on, that was over an hour ago. Let it go. Or what somebody said to you. I learned this a long time ago. If someone calls you a fat pig, well, they can say that. But yeah, you know, you get a bit offended for 1 second, and then you let it go. Because I keep remembering it. If they call me stupid, why did they call me stupid? I'm not stupid. They don't know that I'm not stupid. You know that, we were just talking earlier about Ajahn Sumedho, because I was with him for many years. I had a wonderful experience once when we were in Doncaster. When I was in Doncaster, we were walking down in the morning for some exercise, and this gentleman on the way to work, he must have been some boss because he was really well dressed, he came up to Paul Ajahn Sumedho, right up to him, nose to nose, and said, "You're old enough to know better." Poor Ajahn Sumedho. I feel so sorry for him. Because in those days, being a monk or being sort of into religion was really being too weird. It's okay for young guys like me, we were allowed to, you know, be a bit crazy and weird when we were young. But he was much older. Oh, that was a bit much. But anyway, that when you look back upon the past, all the bad things which ever happened to you, bad things people say, why did people keep remembering that? You're stupid, why do they call me stupid? Because every time you remember a bad event, you're allowing that person to call you stupid again. For me, you can call me stupid, fat pig, idiot, whatever, tell too many bad jokes. You only tell me that once. I won't keep it. I'll never allow anybody to steal my happiness. If I do, then I am stupid. So, if anybody abuses you, hurts you, only allow them to hurt you once. And then forget about it, let it go. Why not? Somebody cheats you. I suppose the people in business. There are a lot of people in business groups in Singapore and Malaysia. And my goodness, you know, people cheat you here, cheat you there. And so only allow them to cheat you once. What do you mean I should have gone to business with them anymore? No, I'm not saying that. As soon as they cheated you, don't think about it anymore. Because every time you think about it, they cheat you again. When we had a robbery at our monastery over a year ago, some thieves came in, some lowlives, probably drug addicts, some really bad people. They came in and stole stuff from our monastery. They stole a generator, chainsaws, expensive drills, and some of our members, those are really bad, that's double bad karma, stealing from a holy monastery. Oh, they're in big trouble. And I said, listen, they can steal our chainsaws. But I'm not going to allow you to let them steal your happiness and your peace and forgiveness. That I wouldn't allow you to steal. You know what happened? What happened afterwards? Well, we just, you know, forgave, let it go. They can't steal our happiness. But it was all insured. So we got it back from the insurance, you know, after paying off, after, you know, not getting the excess back. And even without the excess, we don't get back. We got enough money back from the insurance company that we bought a new generator. Much more efficient and cheaper. A much better chainsaw, again, less price than the old ones. And by the time we've replaced all those tools with much better quality, more modern ones, we still have some money to spare. Because of that burglar, we actually replaced all the old tools and came out with a profit. We were so happy with that burglar. I did ask the police, if you ever find his name, please let me know, because I'll invite him back again. That's how we deal with the past. When I was 19, when I was 19, I fell in love, crazily, madly in love, with a beautiful girl. And after about six months, maybe longer, you know what happened? She dumped me for another guy. She dumped me. Did I have a broken heart? Did I feel badly about her? No! Thank you so much! Oh, if you hadn't dumped me, I'd probably be married and divorced and married again with 6 kids and a big debt and a depression and a... Oh, thank you for dumping me. I feel a lot of sort of compassion for that poor guy who had to say. Thank you anyway. But I look at the past with happiness. It's good. So, and the future. Are you afraid of the future? Can't we be a bit wiser so we don't have to be bothered worrying about this stuff? So whoever did what to you, if you hadn't been traumatized, hurt, money taken away, you probably wouldn't be here today, meditating. So please thank all the people who've mistreated you, given you a hard time, taken away your money, dumped you in your relationships, cheated you. Wonderful. That brought you here. So afterwards, send them a letter of thanks to your ex. That would really confuse them. So, and as for the future, people reminded me today of one of those little stories, the good, bad, who knows story. It's a great way of having a good attitude to the future, so you don't need to worry about anything. So when you're meditating, you're free of the past, free of the future. Amazing you can do that, just being here, enjoying the moment, enjoying the days. And this was good, bad, who knows. There was a king who liked to go hunting. He wasn't a Buddhist, he went hunting, like, you know, these guys, they still do this in England, the fox hunting, tally-ho. And, you know what they hunt these foxes for? Can't they, at one time, I think it's good to have video games. Get them all to have it on video games, virtual reality. They can sit in the chair in the home, all dress up, you know, do a horn, and just do it online. Save those poor foxes. Anyway, he went hunting. And being a king, he had to have all his bodyguards and personal hairdressers. And if you don't want to know what why Venerable Chandra is always sitting next to me, personal tea maker. Is that right?
No.
Okay. Personal teddy bear minder.
Okay.
Okay, you don't mind the teddy bear. So, he had all these entourage with him. And he was chasing one of these animals through the forest. And he cut his finger. He had a doctor with him. And the doctor looked at that finger. And he put a band-aid on that cut. And the king said, is my finger going to be okay? And the doctor replied, don't know. Good, bad, who knows? And the king was a bit disturbed that this doctor he employed didn't know his business, didn't know whether it was going to be good or bad. But nevertheless, the king carried on the hunt. When he got back to the palace, he had to call the doctor over again because the finger had swelled. It was infected. So the doctor had to take off the band-aid, clean up the wound, put some ointment on, and dress it with a sterile bandage. And going through that simple procedure, the king asked for the second time, is my finger going to be okay? And what did the doctor say for a second time? Good, bad, who knows? Are there any doctors here? If there are, when your patient comes and they say, what's the results of the biopsy? Good, bad, who knows? Tell the truth. You're a disciple of Ajahn Brahm, you're a Buddhist. Good, bad, who knows? What would they say? They'd probably report you to the NHS. But anyway, they didn't have an NHS in those days. So, you know, actually I was invited to the NHS conference in Birmingham a few years ago to do a presentation. But you know, I refused. I refused. I sent this letter back to the NHS that invited me actually to their annual conference. And the reason was I'd just been to England. And I just returned when I got their email. Please can you come to give a presentation at our NHS annual conference? And I said, listen, I've just done a long flight back. If I do another long flight, that will be bad for my health. You should know that, you bunch of hypocrites, I'm not coming. And I just wrote that or something similar. So it's great that we have a bit of fun and games when you write emails. But going back to good, bad, who knows. And then, a few days later, the king had to summon the doctor again. But this time the finger was in really big trouble. It went black, gangrene, really bad infection. So the doctor had no choice but to cut it off. Cut off the finger. And that really upset the king. So much that he put the doctor in prison. You stupid, incompetent man. I trusted you. And all you did was say, good, bad, who knows? You know nothing about your craft. Now you're in jail. What do you think about that? And the doctor replied, Your Majesty, being in jail, good, bad, who knows? You crazy doctor, and the king walked off. A few days later, when the wound had healed enough, the king was back on his horse, hunting again. And he chased some animal, and the animal was really fast, and the king chased him, and the animal was outrunning the king. And when the king realized that he couldn't catch that animal, only then he realized he was totally lost in the forest. None of his other people could keep up with him. And he didn't know where to go. He had forgotten his GPS. So he was lost in the middle of the forest. And the way he got lost, he went this way and that way, and he got more and more lost by the minute. And he went deeper and deeper into the forest where most people from town never go. And deeper and deeper into the forest, he encountered the native people, the indigenous tribes who lived deep in the forest. It just happened to be their full moon day. The holiest day of their year, where they would usually do an animal sacrifice to bring good luck for the year ahead. But this time, they saw there was a king. So they captured that king, and they asked the priest for advice, and the priest said, well, if an animal will give good luck for us, a human being would give even more luck. And a king, that would give even the best luck, which is so auspicious. So they decided to sacrifice the king. They tied the king to a tree. And the priest came out. And they started banging their drums. Boom, 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 boom. And they started doing the chanting. And I say, do not encourage me. If I was a Christian, I would call it speaking in tongues. But it got to such a crescendo, and someone said, "Stop, stop, stop!" Our sacrifice is not perfect. That man is missing one finger. If ever you make a gift, you know, you see people traditionally, maybe they're offering a gift to a Buddha or to a monk, they always try to make sure it's perfect before they give it. If it's your grandma's birthday, you don't give her a rotten apple, you give her the best. If, you know, sometimes it's the match to the Queen of England's sort of 90th anniversary or birthday or something, people give gifts, they don't give rubbish. You know, I was at this dinner once, the Grand Hall of Parliament in Canberra. I got an invite for a state dinner in the presence of Her Majesty the Queen and Prince Philip, and Prince Edward was there as well. And I actually went there. It was a bit of a rough thing because there was like what they call a dress code with the invitation. I was representing Buddhists. The dress code, I actually read it. I read the dress code. And the dress code was, the first thing was black tie. Now at the time, I've been a monk for many years, okay. I don't know protocol and stuff. You know, sometimes you're very naive, you know, beautifully naive as a monk. So I asked my friends, is that all you wear when you go to meet the Queen? No trousers, no shirt, just a black tie. That's really weird. And they told me, no, stupid monk, black tie is just code. Code for like a white shirt, a jacket, and a nice trousers and black shoes. But it didn't really matter, it didn't really matter. A black tie, they didn't have trousers. So then I looked at the next option. There were three options for a state dinner. And the third option was military uniform. I can't go in military uniform as a monk. You're a pacifist, you're not military. So I started to lose hope that I can go. But the third option, as soon as I saw that, my eyes went wide. Yeah, I can go as that. The third option was long dress. Well, that's just long dress, it's good enough. So I went in long dress, my robes. You know what happened in the Parliament House? I got taken to the side by security. Are you supposed to be here, sir? Well, I've got my invitation, so I'm going to let you through. But it was, but then, he was a deputy prime minister, no, not deputy, the leader of the opposition, King Beasley, very funny man. And when he gave a speech, he said, "Your Majesty, when it was your, I think, 70th birthday or 80th birthday, I was in the cabinet, and we had a cabinet discussion." Because the Queen of England is also the Queen of Australia. It's amazing, it's got the same Queen in different countries. And sometimes these things don't make sense to me. But anyway, so they had to think of a gift for Her Majesty the Queen of Australia, Queen Elizabeth II of Australia. So anyway, what can we get a queen? And it's even harder to get a present for a queen than to get a present for a nun. You know, we don't want anything. Ajahn Brahm, what do you need? Nothing. Elaborate. Okay, if you really want me to give me a gift for all the hard work I've been here, then get a nice shoebox. Nice shoebox. Just wrap it up with nice paper. Put a nice little bone ribbon on it. And say to Ajahn Brahm, with respect, when I open it up, there's nothing in there. Ah, you're so wise. That's what I always wanted. Nothing. Some of you would do that, you know. But actually, if ever you do what, okay, I'm going totally off the subject, but I have fun. You know that sometimes people feel lonely, depressed, no one likes them. We all have those moments. Remember that year? Do this as an experiment. Get a little box and write the four words MOVE on a piece of paper and put it in the box. Wrap it up, really with nice gift paper, a nice little bow, and one of the little dedication cards. And on that card write, to me, with love from me. And then put it aside, and just pretend you've forgotten about it. And then, you actually discover it, or maybe even better, post it to yourself. And when you receive it, oh, it's a present! Oh, how wonderful! And you look at the card, it's to me! Who sent it? Ah, oh, from me, isn't that nice? And excitedly, as you do when you have a present, you untie the ribbon carefully, and you unwrap the wrapping paper, and you open up the box. Ah, love, like peace or forgiveness, a beautiful gift from me to me. Oh, isn't that sweet? No one else will give you a present. Give yourself a present, but give it something which is really worthwhile. Love, forgiveness, peace. I give me peace. Why not? Anyway, if it's somebody you really respect, you only give the very best. So, when it was, he said in front of, I've never actually seen, in any recording, Fitzgerald laugh so much. And it's usually really sour puss. But, can I say that?
Yeah.
Okay. And it was bad language. But in this particular case, Kim Beasley said, well, we're in the cabinet, it's the Queen Elizabeth's birthday, wondering, what can we get for a queen? So after much discussion, they realised the queen likes horses. So, they decided to look around, get some experts, and get a really nice horse as a present for the Queen. Because she likes racing horses. And so they got this really nice horse, but unfortunately it never won anything, and ate a lot. So, on behalf of the people of Australia, Kim Beasley apologised to Her Majesty for sending a dud of a horse who almost ate her out of house and home. Before and I remember just Prince Philip just laughing his head off, almost falling off his chair. He thought it was very funny. Anyway, where did I go with that?
Oh, yeah. Nice in the jungle with the thing.
Nice in the jungle, back in the jungle. Back in the jungle, but you can't give a bad present to a god. Maybe to a queen, but not to a god, so that's really bad luck. So what they did was they had to let the king go. They had to release him. He wasn't pure enough for a sacrifice. He was missing a finger. So they were kind enough to lead him back, it's a bit of a burden to look after. So they took him back, and he found his way to the palace. And as soon as he got back, he went straight to the prisons, to the cells, and apologised to his doctor. He said, look, I never understood you before. You said good, bad, who knows, and I thought you were crazy. You said losing a finger, good, bad, I thought it was really bad. How can you say losing a finger is good? But as it turned out, it saved my life. If I had not lost my finger when I was captured, those indigenous people would have killed me. So thank you, and I apologize for putting you in prison. was a terribly bad thing I did, putting him in prison. And as he opened up the lock and let the doctor out, the doctor said, "Thank you, but it wasn't a bad thing to put me in prison. Didn't I say to tell you, being in prison, good, bad, who knows? It was a good thing I was in prison. If you hadn't put me in prison, I would have been on that hunt with you. I would have been captured too, and I've got taken this." So the moral of that story is, we think losing a girlfriend, you know, getting a cancer, having a problem, ooh, that must be bad. Good, bad, who knows? Don't worry about the future. Who knows what will happen? Now, one of the other real stories, this is one, wasn't a joke. This guy came to see me in Perth a few years ago, and he said that he was in Mumbai doing business, and when the business was finished, he ordered a taxi to take him to the airport in plenty of time to catch his flight. But the taxi driver was in the provinces. He didn't even know the way from the hotel to the airport, and got lost, and lost, and lost, and lost. And the minutes were ticking by, and it was looked really likely he would miss his flight. He told me in those days the flights were often delayed. So he thought, maybe if it's delayed, he can make a flight. But when they eventually did get to the airport, he saw his flight take off. You can tell on the tailwind what the flight actually is. And he was so upset at the taxi driver. "You stupid man, you idiot, you made me lose my flight. What did you do that for? At any places, you should know where to get to the airport. You are amazingly dumb. You made me lose my flight and all my connections. This is a tragedy. You're terrible." And as he was scolding the taxi driver, actually, one of the greatest scolds and curses, which I heard from, it was from another Arab man. He said, "If you really want to curse somebody, so you may have a taxi driver, you know, from the Middle East, and you know, he overcharges you or get lost. Remember this one. You tell them, may the fleas of 1,000 camels infest your armpits." It's not very Buddhist, but it does have class. But anyway, as he was cursing the taxi driver, through the window of the taxi, he saw that aircraft come down, crash. I think it was a KLM flight or something some years ago. It was a real flight, and everyone on board was killed. And this is not a joke, this is a true story, this is how he told it. And afterwards, "You wonderful taxi driver, I love you so much for getting lost." What happened was, you know, that what he thought was a tragedy, you know, missing his flight because of an incompetent taxi driver, it saved his life. And he said it didn't just save his life, he remembered that for the rest of his life. That's why he came to see me. He never gets angry anymore when things don't go according to plan. You don't know what might have happened if you caught that bus instead of missing it. You don't know what might have happened if you kept your job instead of losing it. You don't know what would happen if your partner hadn't looked after you for someone else. Good, bad, who knows? So because of that, the future is so uncertain. You don't need to worry about it. You don't know how life is going to pan out. So, in meditation, please don't go thinking about the future. Don't worry about it. Good, bad, who knows? It's a beautiful saying, which means you don't worry about anything. So, That's a wonderful way to learn how to let go of the past and future. But nevertheless, even though you realize that you shouldn't be thinking about the past and future, it makes sense. People still do that. So why is that? Why is it you don't really need to plan the future? You don't need to think of the past, but why do you keep doing it? That was me years ago, and I thought, what I'm doing is running away into fantasies. It was escapism, that's all. But I didn't mind facing the present moment. And I asked myself, who am I running away from? Since I asked that question, it was very obvious, I'm running away from me. I had a bad relationship to myself. Always criticizing myself. Always saying, not good enough, you could do better. Come on, get a new junk for the change. So, I was so critical of myself that I had a bad relationship, I wanted to run away. And so I changed my attitude to be kind and forgiving to my mind, to my life. And that's why I developed this simile to help you understand what I mean. You could not today because all your mobile phones turned off. But like another day, you know, you've got your mobile phone turned on and you get a call. You get a call from a friend. And they say, are you free this afternoon? You say, yes. Oh, come to my coffee shop. My coffee shop, and I know you don't like going there, but I like going there. So you're going to come to my coffee shop, and you're going to drink a cappuccino. I know you prefer lattes, but I prefer cappuccino, so that's what you're going to eat, a drink. And I'm going to order a chocolate chip muffin. I know you like biscuits, but I like chocolate chip muffins, so that's what you're going to eat too. And I'm going to talk about politics, about Brexit, because that's really important. I know you like talking about your Buddhism silly stuff, but I'm going to talk about Brexit. And I'm going to sit in the back where we can have some peace and quiet. I know you like sitting in the front to watch the people go by, but we're going to sit in the back. And we're going to sit there for 1 hour, do what I want you to do, no more, no less. Now, if somebody invited you out, telling you what to drink, what to eat, where to sit, for how long, or what to discuss, would you be really wanting to spend that time with them? Or would you prefer not to get involved with such a control freak? So what do? You just make up some excuse. Oh, I'm terribly sorry. I got a dentist appointment this afternoon. And they say, okay, maybe next time. And to keep your precepts and not lie, you ring up the dentist quickly and make an emergency appointment. You can take your 5 precepts. And then after making that appointment, you get another call from another friend. He said, hi. Are you free this afternoon? I said, oh no, I've got to go to the dentist. Oh, that's just a shame, your friend says. I know you have this coffee shop. You're always thinking of a marvelous coffee shop. You know, I wanted to see if I could go there as well with you, but I don't know where it is. And you always say those lattes are to die for. And even though I don't want to die, but it must be really delicious, so I want to try one. And you say those biscuits. Those biscuits are so delicious. I want to try what you want. And you're always talking about meditation and Buddhism. You know, I know I'm a sort of a born-again Christian fundamentalist, Jehovah's Witness, but I'm always interested in Buddhism and meditation. I know you like sitting in the back, in the front. I usually like the back, but I'd like to try it, sit in the front with you. And what your response is, if they tell you that they want to go to your coffee shop, Now eat or drink what you like to drink, eat and drink, and talk about what's really interesting you, what would you do? You say, I'll be there, cancelling the appointment, go another time. And you don't spend an hour there, you spend all afternoon there with someone you like and who likes you. And that was my simile for why, when you meditate, you go to sleep or you get restless, you try and escape from your mind because you're telling your mind what to do. You're going to sit on that seat, not on those chairs for namby-pamby cream puffs. You're a real, take the chair away anyway, or the mat away, sit on the hard floor. The Buddha never had a zafu. That's why he got in mind. People are too, they're too just soft these days. And you're going to sit there for 1 hour, not 15 minutes, not 30 minutes, 1 hour you're going to sit there, no matter what, and you're going to watch your breath. Now, you can understand why your mind is so afraid of you, it runs away straight away. So, no way I'm going to stay here. So you go to all your fantasies. You look through the rest of the fantasy to waste an hour. Or all the past, which you don't have to think about, you bring it up anyway. Or you make worries for the future. You don't have to, but anything to escape from you. So that's why the mind is restless. Escaping from you. So instead, I change my attitude. Mind, what are you going to do today? Mind, you want to just think as ridiculous sexual fantasies, that's what you want to do? Fine, off you go, I'll be with you. Do you want to fall asleep? Okay, mind, fall asleep, you're tired. Poor fellow Chandra's been not sleeping and doing all sorts of stuff, organising, really tired. So please do not tell you, mind, if you want to go to sleep, fine. And, or restless, when I tell my mind, what do you want to do? When I'm kind to my mind, you know the reaction after all these years? My mind wants to hang out with me. It chills out with me. It's like, oh, here's my best friend again. Ajahn Brahm and Ajahn Brahm's mind be the best mates. So close, almost inseparable. There's no force anymore. There's no struggle, no concentration. No, you better watch your breath or else. This beautiful relationship, love, with best friends. So, as soon as I have the opportunity, cross my legs, it's like my mind says, yeah, you're back again. And that's where the mind gets so peaceful, naturally. Never underestimate the power of kindness. It's not to all other beings, it's to you as well. Be kind to your body, and your body doesn't get sick. Care for your body, and your body doesn't get in pain. Care for your mind. Your mind would like to be with you. You don't have to be perfect to be a good friend. But look at your friends. Some of the times we like them because they're just like you. Imperfect, stupid, crazy, whatever it is that you're your best friend. I don't know why we're best friends. But you know, well, why not? You don't have to live up to any expectations. You know, when you're with a best friend, you know each other so well. You never expect anything else from each other. You don't have to, you don't feel you have to perform. You've never been judged with your best friend. You just relax and be, you just hang out together. You know each other so well over the years. You and your best friend just love each other, relax in each other's company. So, you and your best friend, you and your mind, hang out together without any force, natural, peaceful. So when you learn how to let go of controlling, learn to let go of hating your mind. In other words, not wanting it to be an indifferent. Giving your mind a break. Cutting it some slack. Letting it be. Loving it for what it is. Then you find your mind is a runaway from it. That is the end, the cure of restlessness. It doesn't want to go off into the past and future. It doesn't want even to think, to plan. It just wants to be with you. Then there is peace. Coming from kindness. That is the trick. Don't force, don't train yourself like in the military. People rebel eventually. So does your mind. But feed it with kindness and it will stay with you forever. Okay, that is some teachings on meditation, also on life. It also learns how to deal with the mind, the basic problems, thinking, wondering about the past, planning the future, when you don't need to do it. Why? Because you're not kind to yourself. Really kind. And forgiving. You and your mind have to live together for many more years, so you better get it together. So, there we go. That's a little talk on meditation. Now, some questions and comments. Is that right? Okay. Questions and comments about meditation. If you need to go to get something to eat or something, or to have other appointments, whatever, please, you're most welcome to depart or go to the toilet. It's not the toilet. Please don't call it the toilet. It's called the letting go room. And if you do go to the letting go room, especially to do a number two, then please apply this meditation technique when you sit on the toilet. Be patient. Don't force it. Relax. And then you don't get hemorrhoids. This meditation technique, it works at many levels. Is that true, you know? That people who control things, the ones with force, and they get sicknesses all over the place. And they never get nice meditation either. Nice meditation just you relax. Totally relax. And things come out naturally. Anyway, any question anyone has? Yes. Sometimes when you get a new experience in meditation, sound familiar to you. So it makes you tense up and give it a bit of flavor. So every development in meditation is three stages which you have to go through. When I make it formal like that and say 1, 2, 3, stage one, so many people actually put their heads up. I'm interested in stages. It's true, it's how people talk. Stage one, stage two, stage three, grade one, grade two, GCE, A levels, O levels, masters, part one, masters, part two. When we do things like that, people actually can understand, but that really, to me, that's crazy stuff. But anyway, there are three stages, sort of, to every new experience of meditation. The first is recognition. You recognize what's happening. And once you recognize it, the next stage is familiarity. Oh, it's just that body disappearing again. And from the familiarity, then it goes to the last stage of ease. It's not a problem anymore. Coming in here, you've got your little place, your little mat, your chair. And please, if you can, use the same mats or the same chairs, because sometimes when somebody else goes and sits in the chair which you sat in last year, someone got very upset. Silly thing. All the chairs are the same, the mats are the same, but in deference to everybody, try and sit in the same place. And I practice what I teach. I'm going to sit in this place tomorrow. As an example of authenticity. So, but actually, if you want to sit in this place, I'll let you not serve the room. But, you have your place, the fear disappears. Because you get used to it. It's the old place again. So that's the first thing with fear. After a while you recognize it. You're familiar and you relax. There's nothing to be afraid of. The other thing with fear is not just the unfamiliar. Well, that's actually similar. Sometimes in meditation, you go to places beautiful, so free. But it's like the person's been in prison. The person's been in prison for many years, 30, 40 years, and now tomorrow they're going to be released. They're very anxious about freedom. They've got used to being in prison. And something different, something they've experienced before. Maybe I don't know how to deal with this. Even though the freedom from prison is obviously much more happy, much more beautiful, much more everything. But still, they're not used to it. And the story which makes this even more easy to understand was one of my favourite stories. It's the last story in the Who Ordered This Clutter of a Dhamma book. There were once there were two monks. Those two monks were the best of friends. And they always hung out together, looked after each other, enjoyed each other's company. And when they died, one of those monks got reborn as a heavenly being because of his great good karma. But the other monk got reborn as a worm in a pile of steaming, stinking cow shit. Because of his bad karma. So, because sometimes you see monks, you think, oh, they're very nice, they're very good, but sometimes they can do bad things, and karma catches up with them. So, anyway, when the heavenly being was enjoying the heavenly pleasures, peace and refinement, he started to think about what's happened to my best friend, where has he got me born? And so, using the psychic powers of a heavenly being, he looked around all the heaven realms, could find no trace of his friend. And then he thought, the human birth is one of the best to get enlightened. Heavenly beings, they just enjoy themselves, they rarely make much progress, but in this realm, that's where you make the most progress. So he thought, my friend being reborn as another human being again. So he searched the realm of human beings, nowhere to be seen. Oh my goodness, Has he been reborn in the animal realm? He looked about in the animal realm, couldn't find him there either. Where has he been reborn? And so he decided to look in the realm of the creepy crawlies, and there he found him. He was born as a worm in a pile of cow dung. Oh my goodness, what an unfortunate rebirth that was. But you can't abandon the thing. So the heavenly being appeared in front of the pile of stinky, steamy cow shit. You know, the cow packs. And he called out, "Hey worm, worm, come out." And the little head popped up. He said, "Hey, it's you. In our previous life, we were the best of friends. I've been reborn in a beautiful heaven realm. It's so wonderful up there. You, I don't know what you did to be reborn as part of shit. But I can help you. I can help you," said the heavenly being. "Come with me. I can take you to heaven." And at that, the worm said, "One moment. This heaven you're talking about, is there any cow shit up there?" "Oh, no! We don't have such disgusting, stinking things up in heaven. Stop calling my home disgusting and stinky. This is my home. It's my food. I eat it every day. It's warm. It's cozy. Why don't you come and stay with me instead?" said the worm to the heavenly being. And the heavenly being said, "You don't understand. Heaven is so much more beautiful. No, no cow shit, no go." So, it doesn't matter how the heavenly being tried to describe the beauties of heaven, still the worm never wanted to go. So, the heavenly being decided in some much more assertive action. He grabbed the worm, and "I'll show you." He pulled him out of the pile of stinking dung, trying to get him to see for himself how superior heaven is to a pile of shit. So, the problem was, the worm didn't want to go. The worm didn't want to go. It was covered with all slime, and wriggled and lied until the worm escaped from the feeders, the grasp of the heavenly being, and dived right back into the deepest part of the ship. But heavenly beings, imagine how refined heavenly beings are. Imagine like the Queen of England doing that, putting its fingers into a pile of shit. Never ever do that. The heavenly beings were much higher for things. So he put his hand into the deepest part, found the worm, tried to pull it out, but because the worm didn't want to go, crawled right back in again. Many times pulled it out and it crawled back in again. Many times. How many years have I been coming to teach in England now? How many years? Oh, quite a few years. Many years I've been coming to try to pull you out. What happens? "I don't want to go." In the end,
the heavenly being had to go back to Australia. Go back there, everyone. Because that's what attachment is. It's my home, it's where I live. So actually, leaving your home, we call your comfort zone. Sometimes fear comes up, "I don't want to go." And sometimes you have to look a little bit more to see that you let go of your body, you let go of the negativity, and you're free. And once when I was at a teaching again at a grief and loss conference, I like teaching, exposing myself to people who criticize. They get a much more understanding of the Dhamma and people. And after giving what I thought was a very, very powerful presentation of how you can let go of grief, why you should let go of grief, the benefits of letting go of grief, and the method, very clear, how you can move beyond greed to freedom. And then after my presentation, this woman came up to me and she was so angry at me. Nose to nose, what right have you to take away my grief? I won't allow you to take away my grief. And it was like trying to pull a worm out of a pile of dung. And the reason was she was actually quite a famous sufferer of grief. She was the mother of one of the people who was killed by a serial killer in Perth. And they never, actually just recently, after all those years, I think they found a culprit. But she was such a celebrity because of her grief. Invited to so many conferences, interviews, to take that away from her was to take away who she was. It was the ego, the attachment, identification. I am that person, the famous grieving mother. And she was actually so afraid that I could take her out of her grief. And with it, she had to lose a lot of what identity she had made for herself. That is what fear is, letting go. But if you ever get fear in meditation, I always talk about that as a wonderful stage. You actually, this is like a coal face, a cutting edge. You're actually about to let some terrible burden go. So if fear comes up, number one, welcome it. It's a good sign. You're getting somewhere. But don't just resist and go backwards. Like taking a child to a swimming pool. The child has only just learned how to stand on dry land, and now it's having to face this water it's not sure of. So sometimes the kid doesn't want to go in. So a caring mother just holds it very safely and just puts a toe in the water. Just for that afterwards. That's nice. Then puts the whole foot in and takes it out. Then the whole leg swishes around. And little by little, you go through your fear. You realize it's actually good on the other side of that fear. And then the child goes fully into the water. And once it's fully in the water, you pass that fear. It's very hard to get the child out of the water again. It lacks it so much. Beyond that fear is freedom. I want you to get in and hear what that can be. Beautiful. Why is that afraid of that? So, little by little, here is a good sign that is something happening. Some feeling occurring. Because you're vanishing. Wonderful. We'll come back again. You're looking at your body a different way. So that's fear. Fear is good. It's a sign of growth. Getting somewhere. Now when you get into the really deep meditations, just a personal simile. Sometimes it's like, you know you can go deeper, and it's so incredibly powerful and beautiful and wonderful. You think, oh, not me. But it's so beautiful, it's so afraid, but it's so attractive, but I can't, it's too dangerous, I've never been there before, this is so wonderful. And usually, it is the bliss, which you can see the joy of freedom, which is so attractive and enticing. In the end, it overcomes your fear. I'm going for it. And that's how you go to the deep meditation. They pull you in, because there's something inside you notices the joy, the liberation, the freedom on the other side of that fear. You know that. You see that. It pulls you over. Tell me about that. But I've let go of a lot. Do I look like a visible monk? So, you know, in the old days, I don't know if they still do that in the advertisements, in the commercials, they have the before and after person. This is a person before they went to
Ajahn Brahm dental treatments. And they all crooked teeth. And after only one meditation session, their teeth are just so smiling and clean and white and sparkling. You know, do you still have those before and after things on advertisement? So that's, I always didn't want to be the before person, the after person. This is what happens when you meditate, when you let go, and you're free. Have I convinced you? Is my marketing technique strong enough? Let's go for it, you'll be fine. Okay. Sorry?
Another one?
Okay, another one. Yes. You're going to faint. Okay. Well, what to do is get a seatbelt.
Can you put the question?
A motorbike helmet. Now, first of all, then if a person feels a little bit faint, then, you know, have you got any blood pressure issues, you know, with your doctor? No blood pressure?
She does.
Yeah, because that sometimes happens. I had one of the monks a long time ago, you know, he was working in a busy executive in some big company. He became a monk, but while he was even an executive, you know, with a very stressful job. You know, he'd always give blood once every 6 months. And in the old days, when I was a young monk, I'd always give blood, go to the Red Cross and donate blood. And I was with him once, giving blood, you know, the Red Cross. And the nurse took his blood pressure, had his records. And she looked at the blood pressure and said, "Wow, your blood pressure has gone so much lower, you know, than in the records." Then she looked up and said, "You're a monk. You're not meditating, are you?" She said, "Of course, I'm a monk." "Oh, that explains it. Because when you do meditate, your blood pressure goes down. That's one of the reasons. Well known. If you have high blood pressure and you meditate, the high blood pressure goes down. But if you've got low blood pressure already, then you should start being anxious about something." Or just, you know, check your medication, check, you know, whatever else you can actually do to keep it sort of reasonably healthy. Medications, vitamins or whatever, have a good meal or something. That's one of my problems, you know, that I'm so soft-hearted. You know, just, you know, people ask me something, I always say, "Okay, that's fine." And sometimes I get into trouble with being so soft-hearted. Because we're soft-hearted, the soft blood vessels, because the heart is just, you know, part of that blood vessel system. So they tell me to eat more salt, because salt hardens the arteries and hardens the heart, so that means I'm not so soft. Is that a good excuse to put more salt on my cheeks? the soft tissues of my heart. I'm too soft, too yielding. I need to be hard. So I need more salt in my diet. That convinced you? Probably not. Anyway, did convince my doctor. Good. Sorry?
I'm sure you have blood pressure. And this is either high blood pressure. You love licorice.
Why? Gets your blood pressure low?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi,
whatever. Well, just, you know, balance it. You know, just a lot of times, if you're really aware of your body, I'm going to mention the piezometer. There's other parts of your body, you know, which you can actually, after a while, you get really aware of. And if it's like your blood pressure levels, or, you know, the salt levels, or licorice levels, whatever else, with a bit of awareness on that one particular problem, you can actually know, "I need licorice now, I don't need licorice, I need some iron tablets, I don't need iron tablets." You can actually self-adjust. You know, there's one of the monks in my monastery. He had chronic back pain, especially when he sat down to meditate. So he went to the doctor, had a CT scan, and came back, and the doctor said, "You've got a congenital defect in your spine. The only thing I can advise is don't sit down, don't meditate." So I'm a monk! And that's like telling a cook not to eat his food. So he said, "Well, I can't help you. Can't have an operation. Nothing will fix it. You just have to bear with the pain then." And that was intolerable. So, you know, he looked around and he got this wonderful advice. And I was trying to find out, you know, what the book was, where it was. Can't find it anymore. It was one of these books about healing when doctors, you know, can't do anything. It's such a simple but a very wonderful mindfulness technique. The book said on either side of your spine there are muscles which most people are just not aware of. You haven't made that neural connection, so you don't know them, you don't feel them. So the first exercise in this book was to take your hand or your fingers and rub those muscles on either side of the spine for, you know, maybe 15 or half an hour. Actually to start sort of stimulating the feelings in those muscles until after many days, weeks, you could feel those muscles without needing to touch them. You know, things which, you know, I don't need to do and I haven't done, I don't know what those muscles are doing, but he, by contacting them, managed to actually feel those muscles even when they weren't being touched. And the next job, exercise, was learning, trial and error, how to stretch those muscles, how to loosen them. You had to actually have some mindfulness, awareness of them first of all. And then, long time, you know, trying to find out how to actually to move them. And once you could actually move them, the next thing was to exercise them. Stretch them, loosen them, stretch them, loosen them, stretch them, loosen them, as exercises every day. And now those muscles are strong enough that they compensate for the weakness and you can meditate without any pain. Yeah. Well, that's one thing to do. You'd be aware of your body and aware just how it works, and then after a while you find that you can understand, you know, when, you know, you're getting a bit low blood pressure, and, you know, just do something about it. Okay, another last question before we finish off for the evening. The night is young. Okay, any questions? Yes.
How do you balance doing and not doing and letting go completely with being as engaged and as contributing to the world as you are?
Yes. If you're engaged and helping out the world all the time, you get burnt out. You've got nothing to give. Don't be a hypocrite, otherwise whatever you do has no authority. I work a lot helping out all sorts of places, but there is a time when I get really tired and I stop and do nothing. That's why I build up energy. Wonderful little technique I was telling Venerable Chandra. What was it the other day? I was really exhausted and really tired, travelling around all over England and having to give talks all over the place. And that's right, we did the half an hour meditation, guided meditation, but it was 5 or 10 minutes where I wasn't talking. So I didn't follow my own instructions. That was it, I'd done my job, 5 or 10 minutes. And really be still. I didn't do anything. It was almost, it's weird, that being personal idea. If I really have to, I'd do it. But I'm pretty lazy. If I don't need to, I won't. So I just absolutely did nothing.
really kept it still. In a moment, no craving, no wanting at all. And this only takes about 10 minutes and all this energy started coming up. Really beautiful energy. And afterwards, I was humming along. So easy. Because that is a free, powerful, pure source of energy, mental energy, which comes when you are not doing anything. You get blissed out, really powerfully mindful. You can even experience that, I hope, during this retreat, at least some of that. And keep it still. It's like people waste so much energy. I'm talking about mental energy. Waste it worrying, striving, forcing. They think that's the way you get enlightened, and you get powerful. It's not. Just sit there, do absolutely nothing. It's a hard thing for people to do. It's actually not doing nothing, it's nothing doing. The two are very different. Okay, I'm going to do nothing, just another task which you give to your mind, another thing you have to achieve. It's totally opposite of that. Being still, not chasing things. Just like that. Do you understand it? Just be. Not judging, not wanting. Just be. And that starts to build up energy. Some of you already feel it touches something really important there. Something very profound. And you don't do anything. Scary, but powerful. And after a while, when you learn how to do that, trial and error, practice. I haven't been meditating a while, so you should expect there's something to show for all those years. The ability just to be. Fire up, you energize up. And it's beautiful energy. It's not like caffeine or strong Sri Lankan tea, which I like. That sort of, you know, it's okay. But this is much more powerful. And afterwards, ooh, now you can serve. Now you can help. You've got a place from where you can help. Certainly, you can't help other people if you help yourself. I have an old story of Siddha Sutras from the Buddha. A person who's stuck in the mud can't help anyone else who's stuck in the mud. But if you're on the dike of the paddock fields, you know, so on the solid land, and then someone's falling in the mud. If you're on solid land, then you can pull them out. But it's important that you manage to do that for yourself, first of all. Here we go again. Just to give you something to think about, there's a saying of Jesus. He who knows himself knows the truth of all things. Have you read that? Because it ain't in the Bible. It's in the Gospel of Thomas the Contender and the Nakamani library of the Gnostic Gospels. What Elaine Pagels calls suppressed Christianity. Teachings which were suppressed, were found in jars in southern Egypt, in the village of Narkomani, translated, early, authentic, something of those teachings which you wouldn't expect. If you know the truth of yourself, you know the truth of all things. Jesus. Stirs people up. But it's there. Anyway, that's how you can help other people. Okay. I think that's enough for tonight. See you tomorrow if conditions are right. And to end up with, we've got to set up to end up with three sadhus.
All right.
Yeah. Now, instead of clapping, in the Buddhist tradition, we say sadhu after the talk is finished. So, two sadhus. Good enough. Give it everything you've got. You know, people go to churches and temples, especially young people, so boring. People don't put energy into what they do. So this is how you do three sounds. So. So. See you in the morning. What time are we coming in the morning? 9 o'clock?
Yeah, arriving at 9.
9 o'clock?
Yeah.
So please, you know, when you go out, this is the first night, a bit more sort of active, but when you come in here tomorrow, please be quiet.